Hello everyone, this is the fourth part of research meetings with Cansan Çağlayan. As you might remember that Cansan is explaining us and sharing her findings about multi-class text classification. Before getting the details of this research meeting, I would like to kindly remind that on Murat Karakaya Academy YouTube channel, I mostly share deep learning tutorials with Keras and TensorFlow in English and in Turkish. If you are interested in deep learning, you can subscribe to my channel. Today we are gonna continue with the text classification with Cansan. As you might remember that in the research meetings, Cansan already explained us about controllable text generation and then multi-class text classification with a transformer encoder block. And then she explained us the pre-processing matrix cross-validation for multi-class text classification. Today, Cansan will continue explaining how to implement three different deep learning models. First of all, Cansan, welcome back again.
Hello, hocam. Thank you.
How are you? Everything is fine?
I'm fine. Thank you. Everything is fine.
Okay, after this intro, you can start, if you like, to share your presentation and please explain your findings, how to you deal with multi-class text classification with several deep learning models.
Hello everyone. I'm going to explain the text classification results today with using the three deep learning models. First of all, I will show you my outline. I'm going to remind you our data set, and it's just going to be a short reminder. And then I will show you the custom transformer encoder, our first model, and results with the validation data set for this model, and results with the k-fold cross-validation, and the last results. And then for the convolutional neural network, I will show you the same things. And then I'm going to show you the BERT and with the last results, then compare by the train data ratio for the 1% and 3% of the full train data.
So, Cansan, as you show in the initial presentation, you have two custom deep learning models, and the last one, the BERT, is pre-trained one, right? So the audience can understand how to design two custom deep learning models and implement on a multi-class text classification problem. And the last one, the BERT model, actually is a transfer learning model, right? Mm-hmm. So it's a already trained model. Mm-hmm. You are gonna show us how to use a pre-trained model in our solution.
Yes.
Yes, please continue.
So let's remind our data set. Our data set was the multi-class classification data set for Turkish. It's a benchmark data set for the Turkish text classification. We have 430,000 comments, reviews or complaints about the 32 categories. The categories like tourism, health, education, electronics, some services or products. And each category roughly has a 30,000 comments. So this is our total data size, and we have 32 categories. And as you can see, our data set was balanced.
Let me explain again or remind again. In the second and the third parts, you already explained the details of this data set. So anybody's interested in this data set, he or she can find in the links in the video description and access this data sets and access your explanation. Right?
Yes. So that's why I'm not going to get in detail about the data set, because you have already said we made some explanations or analyses about these data sets in the earlier videos. So we also explained the data cleaning about that video. So what did we do? I converted text to lowercase, removed the punctuations, removed the Turkish stop words, remove the URLs and HTML text numbers, and also convert the Turkish characters to the English characters. This was the data cleaning part for me. So also we were using the text vectorization, but again, I'm not going to in detail about that because there was in the already in the videos. So I'm going to continue with the data split. So first of all, I'm going to split the data, the 80% of strain size and 20% of test size. Then for the first experiments, I'm going to take a validation data set because I'm trying to find the hyperparameters and check my models. So that's why I'm going to take the validation data set from the train data set, all train features and all train targets. So 90% of this one is going to be the train. And then the 10% of the train data set, it's going to be a validation data set.
Thank you for this clarification, because it's really important for the audience to understand that for model selection and fine-tuning the hyperparameters, we need to split a data set, such three data sets. So the test, validation, and train. By using the only validation data, we need to fine-tuning the hyperparameters and decide which model to use. After freeze our models, then actually we need to combine the train and validation data set into a single train set and train the selected model last time and then test that model with the test data, as you will do in your thesis, right? It's really important. So validation data will be only used for model selection and fine-tuning the hyperparameters.
Yes. So after the splitting operations, so according to the whole data, these are our train data size, validation data size, and test data size. It's going to be like this. So what are the models? First of all, I'm going to explain the custom transform encoder model with the one transformer block and convolutional neural network 1D and bidirectional encoder representation from transformers BERT.
So let's remind or correct here that the convolutional neural network model also a custom model, right? The last one is the pre-trained one. So let's be specific for that, okay? And the convolutional one, you are going to use, of course, one dimensional convolution for the text data set.
So first model is custom transformer encoder model with the one transformer block. So for the text classification, as you are explaining all the time, actually, in your videos, we can use the transformer encoder part because we can remember that for the controllable text generation, we were using the transformer decoder part because the decoder has a head attention, and we can predict the next word with a shifting input. But in the transformer encoder part, we can use some specific problems like the text classification, because the transformer encoder part is going to find a new representation of the whole sentences, and then it's going to be look at the whole sentence simultaneously. So that's why we don't need to use a mask part in here, like the text generation. So we can use for the text classification. So this is the summary of our model. We have an input. So I forgot add in here, but I'm using a vocab size with the 100K vocab size. And also I'm going to take the maximum length as a 40. It means that I'm going to 40 tokens for the each input. So I forgot right in here. That's why
we already discussed these hyperparameter values in the previous tutorial. So if anybody is interested in this custom transformer encoder model and or interested in the pre-processing of the text data and how we prepare this text data for any deep learning model, should refer to the previous two tutorials. I will share the links in the video description right now, so anybody can access these two videos for the details.
Okay. So that's why we have a 40 max length is 40 for us, and we have a token position embedding, of course, for the transformer block, and we have a transformer block and every global average pooling 1D and dropouts before prevent the overfitting, and also we have a dense layers in here. So at the end of it, we have 32 categorized. So that's why the model is going to try to pick the right category for this one while running.
Let's be specific. Here, when we say category, class, topic, we mean the same thing, right?
Yes.
So here are the, in our data set, we have the reviews, which are double complaints, which are written for the 32 categories, 32 classes, 32 topics for us. When we refer this topic, categories or the classes, we mean the same thing. Okay.
Yes. Like tourism, health, education, electronics, we have some different categories, 32 categories. So this is our model. There are already a summary of it. So I'm using the embedding dimension 32, number of heads is 2, and feed forward dimension for the 64. So I've tried some different dimension values for those things, but I found that I tried to make this similar with the convolutional neural network. And then I examined that, for example, for the feed forward dimension, 64 is going to be the best results.
Okay.
So I tried some things in here, and also as you have already explained that, so embedding, if the embedding dimension is less, it's going to be better.
Of course, let's discuss a little bit about the hyperparameter tuning here. Actually, the difficulty in deep learning is that you have a number of options to decide. Yes.
And there is no right answer.
Yes, and you need to try and see the output. It's mostly depend on your data or your training cycle, a little bit chance. So you need to try to and observe the outputs, and there is no correct or right answer for setting your hyperparameter values. Of course, you can set up higher values. Mm-hmm. But sometimes the higher values wouldn't help you, or it leads to overfitting. Lower values, on the contrary, can lead to you underfitting. So you try to find an optimum point between this. And plus, of course, we are limited with our main memory and the speed of the GPU or CPU. So hardware limitations. It is an art for that reason. You need to play with these, and of course you need to be understanding all the details of these, the meaning of these hyperparameters. You need to do some educated guess, not wild guesses. I believe that during your experiments, you gain some educating guess, right?
Yes, that's right. And I tried some numbers because I had to, because as you have already said that there's no one answer for this one. So I had to try some values. So this one was the better. For example, 64 was the better from the 33 for the feed forward dimension.
And do you think that it is time consuming, right?
Yes.
Trying to all of these videos in a custom model, it's not easy. The creating the model or copy paste some code is easy. Mm-hmm. But understanding your data and then understanding your model and then make them together work.
Yes, it takes so much time.
And effort, right? So, and you need to also record all the results, right? To compare the records later and analyze the effect or impact of the hyperparameter values, right?
That's correct, yes. And it depends on your problem and data, as you already said that.
Yeah, so I think most of the most of the time in the research we spend on fine-tuning the hyperparameters.
Yes.
And of course, if you change the model, then you need to restart again.
Yes, I had trained those models So many times I couldn't remember how many times I trained them.
And you need to keep doing this good, because otherwise if you lost your locks, mm-hmm. you need to restart and reset all the settings. So what we are suggesting here for anybody actually implementing a solution in deep learning must be ready for logging all the experiments with the hyperparameter values. And when the model changes, the architecture of the model changes, you need to restart with things. Of course, there are some rule of thumbs or thumb rules, but it is not easy to access these values or these educated guesses in one night. So we are sharing this kind of research meetings to help the new beginners on the area in the research field, so that they can have some feeling about how we do it, the research in actually, because in most of the time, if you read any paper, published paper, mm-hmm. you understand that somebody find the best solution somehow, magically. Mm-hmm. Actually, behind the scenes, there are many try and fails, right?
Yes.
And there are lots of hours spent on fine-tuning the hyperparameters and selecting the one of the best or optimum model architecture. So we need to emphasize this. This is not magic. This yes. is not a written rule. Do this. The 64 is good for everything. I don't know. 257 is better than 46. Mm-hmm. There is no rule like that.
Yes. So we and need sometimes to emphasize that. It depends on the train size, actually. So some papers can find this convolutional neural network is the best for their data set. But the data size is very different. For example, we have a large data size in here. And sometimes it depends on the data size also, because you couldn't find the best convolutional neural network, for example.
Let's be honest. Actually, today, research, we need a very good hardware to begin with, I believe. Of course, you need to understand the code, the philosophy behind the deep learning, and you need to understand your data. Everything's okay with that. But after that, in the end of the day, you need hardware, because you try many different things to observe the impact. Actually, you observe if the model behaves as you expect from it. So actually, if you are a new researcher on that area, please do not forget that you need good hardware for start.
Yes. Okay, let me continue with the results. So first of all, we are using the validation data to take some results. And also in that point, I need to decide the epoch number. So how many epochs I'm going to use for the last result. So that's why I used an early stopping from Keras. The early stopping is something like that. It's going to stop your training when the model is starting to overfit. So that's why I'm using I write the 20 epochs for the maximum, and I will give the 3 epochs for the patients, and it's going to be a wait for the 3 epochs at least. And then
you are monitoring on which metric? Because in early topic, you need to specify the
Validation.
Let's be specific, because it could be different things.
Yes. I'm using the early stopping according to the validation loss. And then, as you can see, we have a 5 epoch in here, 5 epochs, but with the patience tree. So when the epoch 5, it's going to be stopped. So it means that actually the 2 epochs can be enough for the transformer encoder model.
Do you understand from that result? If 2 epochs are enough to train your model?
So after 2 epochs, I think this is very soon, it's starting to overfit.
So do you think that your model is very powerful?
Yes.
Actually, according to the data set,
mm-hmm.
your model can be trained in 2-3 epochs, means that your powerful maybe is unnecessarily complex for your problem, for your data set, most probably, right? So stopping, early stopping is one way to avoid overfitting, you are right. But what would be the other ways to avoid overfitting? Do you have an idea?
We have already had some dropouts.
Yes.
I know that. And
then
also K-fold cross validation we can use. And I use that. I will explain
K-fold, that. Cross validation wouldn't help overfitting. No. It is a method for checking your model performance when your data is less.
Yes. But again, but at least I can see that it's not trained to for the one training data set. So I'm going to see that with the 5 different trained data sets. So that's why maybe it can give me a feeling about the overfit.
You mean that you would like to decrease the training set, actually, right? But if you remember your custom transformer models hyperparameters,
mm-hmm.
you would like to, for example, decrease the dimension of the embedding,
yes.
of the positional embedding and the self-attendance, right? So
yes.
attention linear output. You have several other hyperparameters
mm-hmm.
because if you can just postpone the overfitting until 5-10 epochs, so most of the time your testing accuracy would better off.
Yes.
So stopping at the early epochs wouldn't help you increase your accuracy at test time. Instead, decreasing the capacity of a deep learning model
mm-hmm.
in the training and then test with the test data, then you can observe, most probably, there is no guarantee, an increase in the test data accuracy. So I suggest you think about that and try with a couple of experiments, decrease mm-hmm. the dimension of the positional embedding and self-retention layers output dimensions. And mm-hmm. you would see that the with 3 patients, the early stopping maybe occurs at this time at the 5th or 6th epochs, then the sparse categorical accuracy might increase in test time.
Yes.
Okay, you can try with this model a couple of experiments. You can add to your research as well in your thesis. So you might say that decreasing these hyperparameters from this number to this number maybe wouldn't help in test accuracy. Maybe it would help. Then you might keep these numbers as your default values for future experiments. Okay?
Okay, I understood.
Okay, let's continue.
Okay, these were the graphics for the accuracy, the sparse categorical accuracy, and for the loss in the model transformer. So as we can see, after the 2 epochs, actually, it's going to be an overfit. Yeah. And then I try to K-fold cross-validation.
Yasan, could you please go back?
Yes.
So on the slide, I cannot differentiate if there is a dot there, 2.5 or it's 25 epochs.
Here. So it shows us the actually with the half parts. So yeah. That's why it's going to be more than this one.
Okay, so please modify these graphs, figures, mm-hmm. such that they are only the integer numbers. Because when look at these at the first time, I thought that there are 40 epochs or so, because I couldn't recognize these the dots over there. You see?
Okay, I'm gonna.
So just configure your figures such that it could show us the integer numbers in the epochs axis. Okay.
Mm-hmm. All right. And then I'm going to try to k-fold cross-validation with the all train data. As you can remember, we split our train data for the train and validation. So now I don't need the validation data in here because it's going to split itself while in the for loop. So that's why I will give the all train data. And then it's going to be randomly split the data for the train and test. And then I'm using the five folds to do this. And with the two epochs, because I've decided that two epochs is going to be enough. And then for the each case, actually, I can see that the results, sparse categorical accuracy, is all of them is near to each other. So there is no big difference, actually.
Well, what is the implication? So what you would understand from that table?
So then I can say that it's not going to fit the only one train data. So it's going to always changing for the all train data set. And it's going to split the randomly, but the result is still be the same. So then I can say that it's this model can be used for those data and it doesn't matter how you split the data in here.
Okay, thank you.
And then I'm going to look at the last results. For the multi-class classification, I can use a classification report, and classification report will give me precision, recall, and F1 score for each class.
Johnson, okay, let's be specific. You mentioned classification report. Actually, you refer to the scikit-learn library. Yes. Classification report, right?
Yes, so
there is in Python, in machine learning environment, maybe most of the people knows this, but let's remind that there is a classification report function in scikit-learn library. So you are going to use this library.
Yes, and it's very useful because you can see the all the classification metrics in a one table. So it's going to give me the precision, recall, and F1 score. So precision is the how many of them are actual positive. And recall, it's going to be the how many of the actual positives our model captured through labeling it as positive. And F1 score, it's going to be the weighted average of the precision and recall. So I can see the metrics for the each class and also the weighted average. And I took this part from your works in here because I'm going to see the weighted average mostly. So averaging to support weighted mean per label, but there it's something like this actually. For the 32 categories, we have 32 class actually. We have the precision, recall, and F1 score, and also we have some average values. So for the custom transformer encoder model, first of all, I'm going to train my model with the all train data again. So I don't use any validation data anymore. I'm going to use the all train data. With the two epochs, I have already decided the two epochs would be enough. And then I checked the lost and sparse categorical accuracy, and I took 95% is accuracy in here. And also these classification metrics, it seems correct because the F1 score actually in the most papers, they looked the F1 score for the multi-class classification, as I see that. And it's going to be again, 95% in here. So this is the classification report table.
What do you feel about that result? How do you feel?
With the
95% accuracy.
It's very high, I think. But for the one transformer block, and data is very big. Maybe that's why there are many data for the transformer block. And maybe it's the reason, I don't know. But the result is very good, actually.
Okay. I agree with you.
Thank you. So this is the confusion matrix, but it's
unreadable.
Yes. And convolution.
But before moving on to next model, could you go two slides back, one more? Here, actually, you need to be careful about all the classes or all the topics. So you need to skim over these numbers. For example, F1 score, recall or precision for each of these classes. And you need to maybe emphasize the class with low or the lowest values with precision, recall, and F1. You need to report these classes. If there are some classes with very low values or lower values, then you need to come up with some explanation why would these classes exist. Okay, why these classes has low or have low precision recall F1. And moreover, in the next slide, you need to also monitor the differences, the distribution of the mislabeled data. And for example, you could say that the shopping has several mistakes, and these mistakes are distributed with over the internet class, for example. Then you could have some explanation why we have some mistakes in that class. So the last two charts or two figures, you need to go over each class results, and you need to understand why and how the mistakes occur. And then you need to maybe come up with some proposals to remove these mistakes. If you go back to your data preprocessing or your model, you might come up with some good ideas to prevent these mistakes occur. So there is a cycle between the training, testing, and model construction. And of course, data preprocessing. You need to use this cycle. But now we have only one time cycle. You just preprocess, train model, test model, and you stop. You just report the results. Then now at this time, you need to go over the results carefully. You need to locate the errors, and you need to think about the reasons of these errors. Maybe you can avoid these mislabeling when you change something in data preprocessing, model architecture, testing, and training. Okay, you need to think about that.
Okay, I understand. Thank you. And by the way, I didn't remove the rare words in here, for example. Maybe I should.
So, when you understand the possible error reasons, you might go over the pre-processing and you might change your options. Maybe you downsize the dictionary. Maybe you extend your dictionary size. Maybe you decrease the maximum sequence length. Do you understand me?
Yes.
So you might need to play with some hyperparameters to decrease the number of mislabeled samples. But you need to understand when and why your model is assigning mislabels to the samples. Even you need to maybe go into the samples, mislabeled samples. Maybe you see that they are actually in the train or test set, they are manually mislabeled. Maybe you will correct them. Do you understand what I am talking? So you need to think about a cycle. Not only once you will just pre-process, train, and test and stop. No, you need to go back and go over the each sample, because if the model is so successful, a deep learning model, I think that maybe the mislabeled samples actually are mislabeled manually in your test set. Maybe you will correct it.
Yes, it could be.
Yeah.
So you should constantly going back to beginning.
Yes, yes, yes. So that's what I'm trying to say 10 minutes ago. So it takes a lot of effort, patience, and thinking out of the box again and again.
Yes.
So it's not only just copy some code from some blog, even my blog, and then run, make it run, and everything is magically solved. No, in real life, in research and in implementation, in real life, you need to go over again and again the same processes with different hyperparameters, with different approaches, and with different thinking. So you need to think out of the box again and again.
Yes.
All right. So please note that looking at these two charts, don't use the only the results here. Mm-hmm. Try to find the possible errors in the data, in the pre-processing, in your model, and think always that how can I improve more and more and more. After that, please try with another deep learning model. Okay?
Okay, I got it.
And in your report or in thesis, please include these observations and maybe you will improve it and then add this improvement into your report. As I suggested, when we read some papers, we believe that everyone at the first time just discovered the perfect result, but it's not the case. Everyone is spending its 1 year, 2 years in a PhD dissertation or the master's degree, you know this, right?
Yes, I know.
Okay, let's continue.
Okay, let's continue with the convolutional neural network. And this is our model. Again, I had to try some dimensions in for this model, for the embedding and feed-forward dimension. And according to those tryings, I found that this one, it was the better solution. So, I didn't add the model summary in here, but as you can see, we have an embedding layer, one-dimensional convolutional neural network in here, and max pooling and dropouts also for the, avoiding the overfit. And then we have a dense layer according to the number of categorized, because the model tried to find the which class is correct for that input. And our metrics are the same with the custom transformer model. So first of all, again, I'm going to make the same process with the previous model. First of all, I'm going to use the validation data with early stopping patients 3. So for the convolutional neural network, as you can see, early stopping has stopped with the epoch 11.
11?
Yes. But we have a patience in here with the tree. And then this was the last result. So the it was the 95% of the transformer. And here I could find the 93% for the test data. So this was the result. So it's similar, actually. But we have a difference. So transformer encoder was better for now. And again, this was the graphics. So this one is correct. Actually, the epoch numbers are integer in here.
Okay, that's time is correct.
Yes,
I mean, not correct, but understandable, right?
Yes, understandable.
But this time, do you run until 11th epoch, so 0 to 10, right?
Yes.
But let me ask you a question. When you observe the convolutional neural network result is almost similar or the same with one transformer encoder block. What do you feel?
According to the graphs.
Yes. So according to the results,
convolutional
neural network model produced almost the same result, similar result.
Yes.
Or comparative results with the encoder block.
Yes.
So we believe that the encoder block is a powerful approach, right? Transformer encoder block. So what do you feel that how could be they are generating so close results?
Yes, and convolutional neural network is also is very good for the text classification, I think, multi-class text classification. So the transformer is better, but not that much. So means that I think we can use both of them for the text classification at this moment.
If I were you, I would reply like that. Please don't forget that in our first model, we only use one encoder block.
Yes, we can.
In original transformer architecture, the encoder of the transformer has, am I wrong, how many it was? 96 yes. Encoders, I believe. Encoder
blocks. Also, BERT has 12 transformer encoder blocks.
12.
Yes.
But we only use one of them. So my answer would be that, sir, don't forget that. Here, I only used one encoder block. And then the question would be here, why would you use only one encoder block in your first model? Why wouldn't you use 10, 7?
Because it's already very good. So if I start with the 10 or 5, I couldn't compare with the convolutional neural network, I think. But
our aim is to find one of the most useful model. We don't want to set the convolutional neural network, of course, but if it is the loser, what can we do? So
yes, but according to the simplest versions of the models, if I found the better one, then I can improve that model, I think.
Okay, but you need to think about that, because anybody would ask you, okay, if the transformers are strong,
mm-hmm,
complex models, why would it be similar results with convolutional neural network, which is very simple model?
Yes.
The number of parameters. For example, can you mention about the number of parameters? Do you know by heart, or do you know any? So in that kind of comparisons, please do not forget to add up the number of model parameters, trainable parameters or untrainable, and plus the training duration. Both of them will give us an understand a feeling of the complexity of the models, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because here you only compare the results.
Yes.
Right? For a pragmatic reason, it is okay. But if you would like to gain some insight about these models, also, we would like to know the number of parameters and the duration, training duration of these models, then it could be a fair comparison with the models, right? Because somebody would have less time. For example, maybe you would like to train with less powerful platform. You would select convolution 1D instead of a whole transformer model. So to understand this difference, please, in your reports, share with them the number of the parameters,
mm-hmm,
and plus time, training time.
Yes, I actually add the training time in here, but it's something like that.
But you need to think about each epoch or average epoch, because some of them is 11 epoch, the other is 5 epochs. Am I right?
Yes, it depends on.
So you need to provide the average epoch time, for example.
Yes.
In training. And what about the parameters? Number of parameters? Do you have any numbers?
No, I don't have any.
So include these two important metrics,
mm-hmm,
when you introduce your model, yes, and the results.
But for the text data, it feels like it should be transformer, because it's looking at the simultaneously and the each word, and the self-attention, it finds the relationships of the each words and according to one word. I don't know. Yes, convolutional neural network is also good, but it feels like it should be transformer, I think.
But if you consider the convolutional, it is also a kind of,
mm-hmm,
self-attention, because you are attending the localized text or the let me say the tokens.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, so we have the filter size, and yeah, using this filter size, actually you are just dynamically focus your attention on some part of the input, and you are doing this by splitting the input several inputs. Actually, the convolutional neural network actually is a kind of attention. But as you know that the attention concept has arrived later, the latest one. So the concept naming is different. But actually, for me, if you think in deep, the convolutional neural network in two dimension, one dimension is a kind of attention. Because in image processing, you are focusing your attention to some part of the image, right?
Yes.
You strip the image with some filter. You are just looking some part of it. So these parts are actually just continuous parts on the image.
Mm-hmm.
Attention is similar, right? If you think attention layer, self-attention layer, let me say. In the self-attention layer, actually you are attending your attention on the input and side by side in the token by token in the text. So it is similar. And you notice that the transformers, there are some research attempting to apply transformers onto image data sets.
Yes.
But most of the time, convolutional neural networks has enough good results.
For the image.
Because actually for me, they are very similar approaches. Focusing attention on small part of the input and continuously you are just swapping on the input.
Yes.
Generating the many different layers of conception, understanding of the input.
But for our problem, I think if I can increase the max length, not 40, let's say 100, transformer make a difference according to the convolutional neural network, I think.
It is arguable. Because if you remember the pre-processing results, we found that 75% of the reviews has less than 50 words.
Yes.
So increasing over that, you could only get 25 more samples information. But the rest of the 75 of the reviews already has less than 50 words. So I don't think so.
Yes.
Because most of the sequence will be the void. So
yes. Maybe I can try with another data set, just more than 40 words.
Maybe, but we know that the convolutional neural network is good for this sequential input.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that the most important thing here is the data. Because the selected data set has 400K samples, right? More than 430K size samples. And even with 32 topics, still it has lots of data to train the convolutional neural network.
Yes.
Maybe we can here explicitly say that you and me, remember, tried the smaller percentages of these trains.
And I will show you that actually. With the 1% of data, it's going to be a bigger difference.
Yes, that's what I'm going to explain. Maybe in a future tutorial, we will talk about specifically how the data training data size impact the performance of these three models.
Yes.
When you finish this chapter, maybe we will have another session for that. But for that discussion, I think the audience is now has some insight why the a strong encoder block produces similar results with a simple model with convolutional neural network.
Yes,
that's important to understand. I believe, and we already witnessed in our experiments, we don't share the experiments here right now, but if you decrease the number of training set down to 1% of the existing one, then we observe that the convolutional neural network just fails.
Yes, in here, actually, there is enough data for the CNN. So That's why I think it's really good.
Yes.
But I will show you some results for the 1% and 3% of training data.
Okay, let's continue.
So then for the same process, I need to check the K-fold cross-validation with the old train data with 5 epochs and 5 folds. Maybe I can choose more epochs, but it takes so much time. So that's why I choose the 5 epochs in here for the 5 folds. Again, I can see the similar results for the randomly selected train and test data sets for the cross-validation. It is very close to the transformer in here. And then for the last results, again, I used the old train data, train and validation with the 5 epochs. And I took that 94% for the sparse categorical accuracy. And we have precision recall and F1, again, a classification report for the each class and the average values in here. So I think... Okay, it should be a weighted average in here, but the picture is wrong. And we have a confusion matrix for the convolutional neural network again, was the same process. And then I choose a pre-trained text classification model, BERT. It contains a 12 transformer encoder actually, and it's already trained with the Turkish data set because I'm using the BERT-based Turkish uncased model from the Hugging Face. And I'm going to take some results in here. So BERT takes so much time, so that's why I'm using 2 epochs. And also I'm not going to save the model because then it takes hours and hours. And actually still it takes so much time, but it's better. Sequence length was 40, it's the same, and batch size it's the same. And then I'm going to use 2 epochs for the Turkish-based uncased BERT model.
But but let's give some credit to the simple transformer library.
Links in here.
Yes, because there is one good guy who prepared simple transformers library. So by using simple transformers library, actually it's very simple to use the Hugging Face transformers easily and simply. So let's give the credit to this guy, right?
Thank you. Simple transformer is very useful to use the Hugging Face model. So that's why I can use the easily the BERT-based Turkish uncased model in here, in my notebook.
And secondly, in the end, you need to save your model, right? So you need to, maybe during training, each effort, you wouldn't save it. But after you finish with the training, you need to save, right?
Yes, I have.
Don't forget it, because in the future, I believe you are going to use in controllable text generation this model. So please do not forget to.
Yes, but I'm not sure that I should use BERT. I know it's the best one, but training is so hard. So it takes so much time.
You know that after training in inference time, it should be very quick.
Yes, and it's a better performance actually because we have a 97% for the those classification.
Okay, before getting into the details of the results, I kindly remind you that again, please share the number of parameters of the model and the average epoch duration so that we can understand the difference between these three models and their complexities.
Okay. Okay, this is the 2 epochs for the BERT. And we can see that precision recall and F1 score, it's going to take the 97%. So far, BERT was the best one, actually.
With even 2 epochs, not 3.
Yes, And then, as we already discussed that, I try to compare those results.
Do you have the loss and accuracy figures for it?
No, no, I don't.
Why not?
I can add, yes.
Okay, please note that as a
human
being, to be fair and show us that if there is the chance to improve BERT or not, because we can look at the loss and the accuracy charts. We can understand that if we need to move on with new epochs or not, if it's overfitting or, but if it's underfitting or just fitting, you need to maybe conduct one or more epochs. Okay, yes. Please include these charts for the BERT as well.
Okay, I forgot that. So now I thought that I can compare those three models according to the reduced data. And then I try to first want the 1% of trained data. I will ask a question about it to you. So first of all, I reduced the trained data with the 1%, and it's going to be 3,470 like this. And I have a train data size. It's going to be like this because I'm going to take a validation data size data set from that train data also. But test size is fixed, right? So should I change it?
No, because our aim is to see the impact of the reduced train size.
Yes.
You can do two different ways. In the first way, at the beginning of the split, you can just reduce the raw data set into some number. After that, you pre-process, then you split the data. At this time, the test data will also be reduced, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But then comparing this result with 5%, 10%, 11% wouldn't be fair.
Yes.
Because in each time, the test data set size also be changing, right?
Yes.
So, but we would like to compare the, not the models, but the models' behavior when we reduce only the train size. So as I shared the code with you, I did it on purpose. We first split the raw data set into train and test. We keep the test data set intact, but we just reduced the train data set later to some point, 1%, 2%, etc. But all the models train with different train sizes, but all the models tested with the same test samples and number of samples. We guarantee that there is a fairness in comparison with different models. Do you understand the reason why we are doing?
I understand. Thank you.
Is it clear now?
It's clear.
Because otherwise, if you select the 5% first, your test data will be X, but 10% your data set, test data will be Y, the Z. So each time there will be different number of samples in the test set. Then you cannot compare the models directly. Do you understand?
Yes. Oh, it's correct. Thank you.
Okay. It is clear now?
It's clear.
Okay, let's move on.
So according to the 1% of train data, now I can compare the precision recall and F1 score for the custom transformer encoder, CNN, and BERT. And BERT was very bad, actually, for precision recall and F1 in here. And transformer encoder, custom transformer encoder, was the best one. So, but BERT takes so much time in here. Maybe that's why I'm using the call-up for this experiment. But the result was like that. So actually, I've done this like this. I want to show you. So I created a for loop like this. And I'm going to try for the each percentage for the train data. And I add everything to the for loop, and it's going to find the results for the each element of the list from the reduced ratio. But I couldn't finish it because the BERT takes so much time. So I look at the 1% of data, and result was like that. So as you can see, the custom transform encoder was the best one in here.
But Jansen, in my experiments, BERT is still good with 1% data. Is there?
Yes, I know, but I
some mistakes? Possible mistake?
Maybe there was a mistake. I don't know. Let me check again. So for the first one, I prepared the data, take the transformer, convolutional, and then for the BERT. Maybe I should check again to this part. So I'm not sure about those experiments, the reduced ratio experiments. So if you want, we can make another session for this one and I can check it.
Yes.
Before that.
There might be some mistake because in my experiments, you know, I shared the collab with
yes,
you.
I know.
BERT is also good at the very lowest values of train set.
I know, but maybe there was a mistake.
Let's check it later, okay, together.
Okay.
Not now, but later. But please drop by my office and let's see if there is any mistake. Okay.
Okay. And then that's all for the comparison of the three deep learning models and the results for the validation data, K-fold, and the
last. What about the full data set result?
So this was the full data sets, all of them.
Comparison of three. Now, in the last slide, in the last slide, you just show us.
Last results of the whole data set.
Yes.
Okay, I couldn't collect them together. Okay, these was the these were the last results actually for the whole data, but I didn't collect them in a one table or here.
Okay, but we are comparing three different deep learning models, but there is no table for that.
Yes, but I can say that 95.
Okay, then let's conclude with your comments.
Okay.
Now please summarize what you see in that data set. You apply three different deep learning models. The first two of them are custom models. You just create the architecture and use it. The third one is the pre-trained model. Mm-hmm. Now please explain us your comments, share your comments about these three models and their performance.
Okay. For the whole data, this was the last results for the custom transformer encoder model. So basically, I can see that 95% of the each matrix actually, and I expect that because transformer model is very complicated and good model. But even with the one block transformer, I could reach those results. But for the convolutional neural networks with the whole data, again, I have a 94% for the each matrix. And I believe that there was so many data. So that's why convolution is also very good and close to the transformer. And for the BERT is already trained model. So I'm just fine tuning with my data set. So that's why the BERT takes so much time, but it's the best one actually. It takes the 97% value for the each matrix.
Okay, which of them you would like to use in a real life situation? Assume that you are gonna deploy this into a commercial website.
Yes.
And when you receive a comment or complaint, you would like to direct this comment to the related department.
If I have a
enough, you would like to implement deploy in your real life situation.
I would want to use BERT, of course, but if I have a hardware, enough sufficient hardware. So if I don't have any sufficient hardware, then I could use one or two transformer block maybe.
So Jansen, to say this, please note that you also have to share the memory requirement of the models. I mean that how much memory they fill in after train. So what is the size of the train models?
Mm-hmm.
You have to report this. Please note that. Because if their model size is considerably similar to each other, they wouldn't require more hardware to store in the website or the in the application server. Secondly, also you need to report us how much time on average requires for an inference. For example, you can do with 10 or 100 tests, and then you just record the inference and divide by these 100. You would tell us that for 100 inferences tests, it takes this amount of milliseconds. So we would understand that if we can use these or which of these models in a real life situation. So two things. First, the train model memory size. The second, how much time they spend in inference time. Because you know that most of the time we train once, but we use the model millions of times in real life.
Yes. So sometimes the best one doesn't mean the easiest one to use, actually. I observed that because BERT, training BERT wasn't that easy. It takes so much time. So that's why I would prefer the Transformer Encoder Block with the simplest one.
Yeah, I see. But these commands are subjective for you.
Yes.
Right? So let's be objective. To be objective, you need to provide us the numbers as an engineer, right?
Yes.
We said that deep learning is a kind of art, but it's not a total art. It's the engineering as well. This is the engineering side.
Mm-hmm.
To do a selection, wise selection, we need some numbers. And according to these numbers, you might justify your choice. Otherwise, now we are just, I think, a subjective choice. Yeah. I believe that, I think that, I like that. But where are the numbers to support this?
Yeah, okay. Right. Thank you for your comments and suggestions. Thank you for everything.
I think you will improve this research. And then we can come up with together again to discuss the impact of the data size. And we can also consider the models, parameter numbers, memory usage, and training time requirements, and inference time. So after that, we can conclude that what to use with that data set, which model we would like to use, and why. Now we would have a educated choice to choose from one of these. Maybe we can add new models like convolution 1D plus LSTM, a recurrent neural network. You might think of that. Would you like to add some more things? Anything to add? Report.
Yes, of course, we can try more models. And there are also some other pre-trained models, like Fast AI. We can add all those models too. Yeah.
Yes. One question for you would be, why BERT? Why not? I don't know. There are many of them.
This was the most popular one, I think. That's why.
But 2 minutes ago, you said that the most popular is not always the choice.
Yes. That's correct.
So please look around. If there are other pre-trained with Turkish text, maybe you can just plug in. And before plugging in that experiment, you just compare the number of parameters. Maybe there are some lightweight BERT models or other models. Maybe because you complain about the time requirement to train the BERT model, maybe you have other models with similar performance.
Yes.
So just look at this and add this to your thesis as well. So somebody would ask you why BERT. Yes. What's the magic with Matt, Bert? Okay.
Okay.
Anything to report or add?
No, thank you.
Okay, so I would like to thank you for sharing your experiences with multi-class text classification with three different deep learning models. We will continue sharing our research meetings with the audience. Thank you for your efforts, Cansel, and hope to see you in the next meeting.
Okay, thank you. See you.
See you.